today we're going to look at how you can go around rendering out a face and using muscles specifically. Hey guys, it's Oscar Baechler here, and I wanted to talk about how you can go about rendering out muscles. This is something I do for practice a lot. It's just a gigantic book I got at one point, and it was really cheap. Part of the reason it was so cheap is because, like, I think it's got all this blank spot. And I realized I have all this area that I can do site-sized copies of stuff. So you can see here, this was their drawing. And I needed a site-sized copy right next to it. By which I mean, I specifically try and draw whatever I'm looking at in the exact same size right next to it. It's almost as easy as tracing. And you learn a lot about just having a good eye for accurate measurements doing it. So you can see I'm pulling these right across, right across. So I did come up with, after doing this for a while, what I think is a pretty okay way of rendering muscles that I think pays a lot of attention to how this is formed. So let's try doing this and going through the process of making a drawing with a face like this. The important thing is I'm going to start with a light medium. So I would recommend an H pencil or perhaps a col-erase pencil. My son is here assisting me. Hi, Felix. High five. Now when I start this drawing off, the first thing I care about is proportions of the overall head. So something like that. I don't know if you can see it, but here's a line around. I'll try and I'm going to purposefully draw a little harder than I would normally so that it hopefully shows up. Instead if I need it. Yeah. Trying to think about anything, yeah. I'm thinking about those big proportion ideas as we go. So does this nose line up with the ear? How is this all going to be inside of a skull cavity? Oh no, what's wrong? Okay. Cat now. So again, when I look at this, I'm trying to see the big ideas before I look at the little ideas. Don't go in and draw this nostril just yet. Like that. Now the fun thing about muscles, I'll wait until I'm working on pens so you can really see that. We can map out some of the major groups of these. You'll notice that a lot of times I use as straight a line as possible, and the real benefit of that is that it prevents you from caring too much about the line quality until it's like the last necessary. care about line quality until the very end. When I have lots of structure in place, and my line quality can just sort of pop out really nice and beautiful at the end. So now I can go in and start caring about things like this nostril. But again, I'm still using this incredibly pretty light red pencil. And it might not be as visible for you, but hopefully the idea is getting across that you don't just dive in with really, really dark lines that you can't repair at all. These col-erase pencils are also really nice in that, I mean, you can erase them. You can fill in a lot of tone with them by broadsiding it. They have like a nice waxy feel to them. They just handle really nicely. I think one of the biggest mistakes I see on heads is people make the necks way too skinny. People really love doing sort of chicken neck things where giant head and a neck that in no way can support it. At this point, I'm starting to draw in a couple more of these muscle groups. And I think this is close enough that I can start going in and rendering it with pen. Now, I have a couple pen options here, and I wanted to talk about them. These are just microns, and they all have a different weight. So the biggest is this 2, and the smallest is 0.1. You don't need a set of every micron. And oftentimes, I'll probably just get away with a 0.8 and a 0.1, or possibly a 2 and a 0.1. But you're going to end up using these for various weights of the line. Oh, I lost one. Right. I'm going to start with my smallest one, because I can always go over these. This is the 0.1. Actually, I'll start with. And I'm going to try and get out some of these bigger shapes to begin with. And there's always something kind of interesting to me when I switch from drawing with pencil and a really light thing like an HB to this, which is you have sort of like highway deceleration where, you know, when I'm working with pencil, I'm trying to draw with my elbow, be fast and loose, get shapes down really fast. And then with these, you have to switch to being a little more careful, but there's also still this idea of you just want one pretty line. So this is where you really don't want to do that back and forth dogleg, dog fur type rendering. So I think about the idea that there's a line here, and then I put it in at the last minute. And I don't care if it's too light right now in the grand scheme of things, because I can always go over it later with another pencil. switch up to the two. Yeah, that's too scary. Alright, it's okay. So if I'm not sure about what I'm going in and drawing, that is a perfect time to go back in. Now, you should learn about muscles specifically after you've learned a little bit about the skull, because muscles function in a very specific way. I'll just jump over here and show that really fast. Imagine you have two bones. Let's just draw a little cartoon bone here. And it's connected to this other bone. And the way muscles work is they have two points. They have an origin, which is like over there, and an insertion, which is right there. And they're going to stretch between those points. And it's like a rubber band. It's going to be tight. It's never going to be something where it's loopy. And the way that muscles flex is that they have a third thing called the head of the muscle. Now, when this muscle head cringes, it'll pull this muscle this way. It'll pull this bone this way. It always works that way. There's no ability for a muscle to push. So when this crimps up, it's going to switch to be something like. Oh, big and strong. And so that's something to constantly focus on when you're thinking about how to render muscles. If you look at this, we have these origins right here and insertions here. Origins are generally the part that's closer to the body, although not always. And the insertion is the farther away part. So the way all these muscles of the face work is they have to have the bone to attach to, which is the skull, right? So this would be an insertion or an origin, and down here is its insertion into this other muscle group. So when this muscle here bulges, it's going to pull your the corner of your mouth this way, and that's how you create a smile. Having a good impression of all this, thank you, Felix. Having a good understanding of where these attach and what they're pulling on is going to make your facial expressions a lot more realistic. The one other thing that you'll often see is, especially on the face, you'll have these ring-like sphincter muscles. Yeah. So the other thing you see is ring-like sphincter muscles. And instead of having an origin and insertion, these sort of just all tense towards each other at the same time to make your kissy face. Alright, gotta go get these pens away from my son. Alright, so now that we know a little bit about how these muscles work, we can start putting them in more and more. Mama. And the reason I use these multiple markers is you start having a variable line weight where the origins and insertions are going to have more lines coming out of them. The areas next to the muscles, because there's occlusion coming in, they're going to have a slightly darker rendering. So, for instance, something like this. And if you do it right, you can have a nice line weight, right? I have this like flick at the end. And that's something I care about as well. So these are attaching, originating from here on your zygomatic arch, I think, and then going down. I just want to make sure that I'm thinking about how tight this line is. This is a 0.8 marker. So let's do the sort of occlusive area for the eyeball here. Okay. Hey. He's sitting on my lap. It's a camera. Switch back to pencil here because I got enough in place that I kind of want to make sure I'm recording where these ink lines are going to eventually go and what masses I'm going to circle. And also, some of this pencil is going to be left over once we start having the ink. It's going to add like a nice secondary light tone, even though most of it's going to go away. You can see on each of these muscles where it's connecting to. Imagine the skeleton under here, or the skull, and where that muscle is connecting to and what it's going to pull on. So this one, for instance, is connecting on the bottom part of your jaw, and it connects to the same muscle around the mouth, I think the orbicularis oris. And so when it pulls, by which I mean from here to here, it bunches up. It's going to pull the mouth that way and make a frown. Give yourself the, if you make it okay for yourself to go and trace over this a second time, you're going to start having some really, really delightful effects. And you're going to start enjoying your pencil work a lot more because since you're using this light medium, again, I recommend H pencils and colorized pencils for this early stuff. Sometimes I also use like a very light marker, like a 30% gray Prismacolor. But depending on how you organize it, it starts to be really, really nice. So that, I'm trying to make sure this is, like, there's a lot of value in just being able to draw a really fast straight line, especially when you're working on these muscles, because that's going to make these insertions feel a lot better. And regarding this mouth here, I mean, it's almost like a spider web where you have like the different starts of the spider web. Each chunk of the orbicularis oris that's connected to a different one of these is going to try and be as taut and suspended as it can. I think they actually removed the muscle from this view, which is of the sternocleidomastoid, which is, in my opinion, the most important muscle. And see, it kind of splits there. But so that's going to connect really right under this ear. And from a front view, you can't really see it here. It's also about as broad as the ear, which is the other thing that you forget. But this muscle goes down and connects to your clavicle. We'll show that from a front view. A lot of times, this is the secret to making nice looking heads, because if you imagine your ear right here, your clavicle down here, and down here, just getting that sense of how those are attached. Really important. And then your trapezius back here is going to wrap around there. I think the trapezius is the other neck muscle that I have you guys required to label, which is like a big sheet that connects down here. See how these muscles go right one on top of another? And don't just necessarily trace this. Try and think, when you see a muscle like this one that's secretly under here, think about what it's trying to attach to and where it's going to based on your reference. And follow along with that. also really love these col-erase pencils because the range of pressure you get off of them is really, really big. And you're starting to see a little hint of how I like to render these muscles, and namely, if we have our origins and insertions, and they're really tight here, and then they have like striations coming towards things. I like to draw those striations really close together. So we can start by rendering the biggest occlusive areas, and now I'm switching to, this is dangerous because it's so big, right? Now once I have these sort of occlusive areas that are extra dark in, I can start thinking about how these muscles work. So they're going to have sort of this tendon flesh at the start where it's not going to quite lead into the muscle, and then the muscle comes out from there. So I'm using a 0.8, and I'm going to and emphasize that. Some good line weight. And you can see what I'm doing. I'm trying to have a nice fall off from the start of the line to the end of it. Also, I've started creating that leftover space for that wider tendon right there. The other thing to do, I just made a mistake there. Try and do different parts of the muscle at different times, because otherwise it's easy to go off course. So I should do one that's kind of like right in the center here, or below the ear. Just know always that your sternocleidomastoid connects below your ear, and that will save you so much sadness when trying to place it later. Once I have some of that in, I can actually switch to a lighter pencil, or a lighter pen, so this is a 0.1. Further try to emphasize those striations with a lighter line weight. And the sort of fall off that you get from the start where this muscle is really bunched up to where it's lighter in the center, creates like a little highlight on the muscle. You can also maybe do more on one side of it. That's kind of my first muscle group. I'll try to get some more of these guiding lines in. Line weight is a big part of good clarity with ink. You can also have a little bit of calligraphy where, for instance, on these shadow sides, like the bottom of the nose, you'll notice that I'm rotating this pen so that it has more weight on that side than the other. I am medium agnostic. I jump around from every possible drawing type to another. This ear, because the hat just kind of looks weird without it. Figure out where I can start having major lines that are darker. This is from primarily a side view, just based off my reference, but you'll learn a lot by trying to draw this from different angles. So normally I've seen this at a front view. long as you're thinking about sort of, you know, light and form. And just hard edges and soft edges. You should always be able to lead yourself in the right direction of how to render stuff. So, you know, a lot of these ideas of how to do muscle striations with pen, I just experimented until something started making sense. So you don't have to think of it as dogma. This is a fun one. See, like, if I keep focusing on differentiating with line weight between occlusive area and stuff like that. Where are you going, Felix? It is 1 a.m. and I wanted to do this video. And Felix is still awake. Oh, you don't want to open that. I'm adding some slight modifications here, and before you go and do this, know that I'm going to be using some stuff like whiteout pens, and there's ways that you can correct that, but I'm also adding just some hints before I go in with this about where things start and what contour they follow. Also do this sort of seven stroke a lot of times, which sort of creates this pin shape of, like a mini occlusion for a single striation. I think it looks pretty good when you do that. For something like these circular muscles, I always struggle to get like a single good pen line for that. So a lot of times, I'll start it going one way and continue it going the other. Give myself some guide marks. muscle-based occlusion here, where two muscles are separate. And I don't feel like busting out another pen, so I'll just trace over it multiple times. Well, it's funny because it's gonna be kind of dry, right, and very anatomical, but so much of the coolest, like, most interesting art is heavily influenced by this, you know, hardcore medical stuff, you know. Skulls are about as metal as it gets, man. Same with skinless people. This is more of that technique of getting my line weight to fall off in one direction and then the other from the same start dot. I think this book actually has a very good collection of photos regarding sort of your palette area. That for the larger obviously, we can't do what Leonardo da Vinci did, and other great artists did, which is actually open up a cadaver. But there's a lot of that stuff on the internet. it is about this sort of pause before you pull off of the micron. And I guess I'll put in some more ear junk. I don't think you guys are required to do ear stuff yet. Just about out of battery. But that's alright, this is just about done, I'd say. Don't forget, you have to label this stuff too, so at this point. The final touch. I can go in. I'll label some of this. You got your orbicularis oris.